السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم وبعد. And brothers and sisters, I was asked to give this last lecture, and so I'm giving it. I call it the last lecture, not because I don't mean that literally, but because to underline one very important point for myself and also for you, which is the point based on which Rasulullah ﷺ said, pray every salah as if it is your last. And so therefore, whenever I do any lectures or I teach any class, I tell myself, this is my last lecture. This is my last class. And I say that because whatever you may have done in life, people only remember the ending. So therefore, it is very important to make sure that the ending is good. Exit on a high. So if something is to be your ending, it should be the best. Therefore, if you treat every interaction as if that is the last, then inshallah, every interaction will be the best. And therefore, I remind myself and you that we should live deliberately, we should live consciously, and we should live with awareness. We should live deliberately, we should live consciously, and we should live with awareness. Because merely to draw breath is not to live. Breathing and living are two different things. Every action must be done consciously and deliberately. And that is why Imam An-Nawawi rahmatullah alayhi in his book, Ar-Riyadu Salihin, in the Muqaddimah, in the opening chapter of the book, in the introduction, he described niyyah. Because the first hadith in that book as well as in Bukhari and Muslim is the hadith of niyyah narrated by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, innama al-amalu bin niyyat, that the deed depends on the intention. So therefore, Imam an-Nawawi rahmatullah alayhi defined intention. And he said, al-idharu niyyah fi kulli aqwal wa fi kulli amal وَفِي كُلِّ أَحْوَالِ الْبَارِزَةُ وَالْخَفِي. Five things. He said, izhar of the niyyah, the awareness of the niyyah, bringing forward the niyyah, understanding the niyyah, remembering the niyyah, expressing the niyyah. فِي كُلِّ أَقْوَالِ, in everything that we speak. وَفِي كُلِّ أَعْمَالِ, in every action that we take. وَفِي كُلِّ أَحْوَالِ, in every condition we find ourselves in. Al-barizatu wal-khafi, whether it is visible and in the outer world or whether it is hidden inside ourselves. Now see this beautiful definition of the niyyah. He said that a person must be aware of the intention of doing something, the intention of saying something, the intention of doing something, and when he or she is in a situation, his intention or his condition in that situation must be top of the mind awareness, whether this is expressed or whether it is inside. So imagine if a person, and what is therefore the expected niyyah of the Muslim? What is the one standard niyyah for every action for the Muslim? The pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Every action, every speech, every action, every hal that we find ourselves in must be only and only for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. So therefore, if a person is aware of this niyyah in every single situation of his life, then it becomes impossible for that person to do anything wrong. So the greatest safety from sin is the awareness of the niyyah. And that's the reason why I say last lecture, not because I know that this is the last or any such thing. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what the future is. But because this is the intention and this is the way in which we need to live our lives. The actual title for this lecture is 10 fundamental lessons that I learned from my life. I hope they will be useful for you as well. The first and foremost fundamental lesson that I learned from my life is to make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the first in your life. I say make Allah a part of the equation because He is in it anyway. Make Allah a part of the equation because He is in it anyway. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a part of the equation in our lives. Whatever we do in our lives, This is being witnessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jalla Jalal. Who was Samiul Basir? He is the one who hears and he is the one who sees. Who Alimum bi Zati Sudur? He is the one who is aware of what is in our hearts. So there is nothing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which is makhfi, which is hidden in this world, whether it is within ourselves or whether it is in the external world. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is aware of all of them. The question is, are we aware of the fact that Allah is aware? And that's why I say to myself and you, make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala number one in your life. Three things to do therefore. One is, inculcate in yourself a love for the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran al-Kareem. The Quran is the closest that we will get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this life. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jalla Jalaluhu to grant us His didar and to grant us His vision when we meet Him insha'Allah al-Musta'an on the Day of Judgment. But in this life, the closest that we will come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is through His kalam, through His speech, which is the kitab of Allah, the Quran al-Kareem. The second one is to see the glory and magnificence and majesty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His creation. To be aware of this and to see the glory and majesty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His creation. My latest book is, the latest book is called A Voice in the Wilderness. The one before that is called The World We Don't See, which is a series of essays on mine on nature and on wildlife and so on. The World We Don't See. And I have differentiated there between looking and seeing, between hearing and listening. The difference between looking and seeing is the same difference between hearing and listening. One is a function of the organ. If you have got functioning eyes, you will see. You will look. If you have functioning ears, you will hear. The other one is a function of the intention. It is an expression of the interest in something. A person listens only if they are interested. Everybody hears it. I mean, if there is sound happening, our eyes at least have lids, the ears have no lids. So if there is a sound, the sound is there. It's going to come into your ears. But whether you are listening to that or not depends on your interest in the subject. Let me give you a very quick and easy to understand example. Many times you might have found that you have some friends and so on in your house and they are visiting you and you are in the living room and maybe you have a small baby, an infant who is in the next door bedroom. Now that baby is sleeping. You and your wife are here in the sitting room entertaining your guests. The baby makes a small sound in his or her sleep. Will you hear it? You will hear it. And between the mother and the father, who will hear it first? The mother. What is that an expression of? The guest probably won't even hear it. Even if they hear it, well, you know, some sound. But for the mother, it is my baby. It's an expression of interest. And therefore, when I say, see the glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm not talking about going there like, you know, usual tourists with your jaw hanging out and hanging down and just looking at things and going, ah, wow. I'm saying, look at the glory of Allah. Look at the majesty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The thing that gives me the greatest pleasure is to photograph small birds. Tiny little birds. Little larks which nest in the ground. They nest on the ground. And they nest in a place which is infested with monitor lizards and with grass snakes and with rat snakes, all of whom their food is bird's eggs. Their food is bird chicks. Yet, larks thrive. Yet, those little tiny robins, they thrive. Tiny little birds. The cover of my book is a little black bird. I don't even know the name of that bird. That's okay because I don't think the bird knows the name either. Sitting on a single blade of grass, and the blade of grass is not even bending. So what's the weight of that bird? Next to nothing. The glory of Allah. The glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not necessarily visible only in the, you know, great and huge and massive things that He has created. I think it's most visible in the tiny things that he has created. One day when I lived in the US in the 94 to 97, I was looking for a place to conduct an outward bound leadership course. So there was one white American guy who told me he had a piece of land in the northeast in Maine, and it was a mountain top, and he said it's a whole forest of oak trees. So we said, let's go see it. So he and I went there, we drove up there, and I parked the car under those trees. And you have to see an oak tree. I don't know how many of you have seen an oak tree. You have to see an oak tree to understand, you know, what a massive creation it is. There are a couple of other tree species which are bigger than that, the California redwoods and so on, for example. But the oak trees are the secret of the British ruling the oceans. The oak is the secret why the British took over the oceans from the Arabs. The Arabs were mariners long before the British. The Norse, the Vikings, were mariners long before the Arabs, centuries before. But neither the Vikings, neither the Norse, nor the Arabs actually ruled the oceans. The British ruled the oceans. And the Spanish ruled the oceans. And the reason is the oak tree. They completely changed the engineering of the ship. And because of the oak tree, they were able to create ships which could cross oceans. The Norse and the Arabs, their ships and their shipping was, they hugged the land. They hugged the land. They were in the shore waters. They never went across oceans. But for the first time, the British created ships, what they call the tall ships. And it's a magnificent piece of human creation. I mean, it was to see a tall ship in action and to imagine that this thing used to be run by people, that they used to sail them and used to raise those sails and bring those sails down and so on, and actually climb up those things in storms. You have to actually first sit in a boat on a sea, in a rough sea. I mean, I'm not talking about a storm, just a rough sea, to even have an inkling of what I'm talking about. But imagine now that, multiply that a million times, on a tall ship, top of the mast, it's in what's called the crow's nest, which is the viewpoint at the top of the mast. I mean, every movement at the ocean level is magnified 1,000 times when at that height on the top ship, and people stayed there in those storms, in icy winds. And they took years to cross the ocean. We're not talking about months here, we're talking about years. And that was the oak tree. So now, there I go to this place, this forest of oak trees, and the ground is bare. There's not a blade of grass, because these trees are so massive and the shade is so thick that nothing grows under it. It's absolutely clean ground. But to my surprise, I see these little green berries. What I thought was berries. The ground is strewn with these little green berries. I'm talking about the magnificence of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here are these oak trees, but maybe 200 feet tall or something. Massive, you can't put your arms around it. Two of us together couldn't put our arms around it. The trunk is so huge. So I picked up one of those berries and I realized it was compacted leaves. It was leaves all together, looking like a fruit. So I asked this friend of mine, I said, what is this? So he must have been Hyderabadi at some point in his ancestry, because he typically like us, if you ask something, ye kya hai? Are nahi maloom. Nahi maloom hai, aapko test karne ko puch rahe. So unhe message kara. I said, what is this? Oh, you don't know. I said, all right, okay. So then he told me an absolutely mind-blowing story. He said, open this. So I opened it, I peeled it, and I find inside that a small caterpillar. A small caterpillar. He says, there is a little fly. This is a tiny little fly. He said, this fly lays its eggs on the terminal bud of the oak. Now, what is the terminal bud? The terminal bud is the growing shoot which is at the topmost end of the branch. So, we're looking at a terminal bud which is 200 plus feet in the air, right? In the middle of all that thick and storm and wind and everything else, way high above. This fly goes up there and lays its eggs and its egg on the terminal bud of the oak. And he says, when that happens, a strange thing happens. He says the terminal bud stops growing and the leaves around the terminal bud start growing and they envelop the egg. They cover up the egg. And he says when it is complete, it drops off. It breaks and drops off. And where does it drop and fall? Under the shade of those oaks where nothing can touch it. And he says this, all those leaves are the food for the caterpillar. So it's like being born inside a bar of chocolate. You can eat your way out. And that is what the caterpillar does. Until the caterpillar comes out, becomes a chrysalis and fly and the fly flies. I started crying. The man said, why are you crying? I said, this is my Rabb. I said, this is Allah. This is my Rabb Jalla Jalla. He makes something as massive as the oak, subservient to the needs of the egg of a fly. The entire growing pattern of the oak changes when that fly lays the egg. Ajeeb the qudrat of Allah. So make Allah number one in your life and recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduced Himself to us in two ways. One is through His creation where He created these things. And I'm giving you only one or two examples. I don't want to keep you here all day. So, do the rest of it yourself. The second way in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces Himself is through His kitab, through His kalam. And in this kalam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces Himself in two ways. One is by mentioning His own glory and majesty. And the other one is by mentioning His ihsanat, His favors upon us. So, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum, la ta'khudhuhu sinatun wa la nawm, له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض ولا يؤوده حفظهما وهو العلي العظيم الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله والله أكبر الله أكبر ولله الحمد هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو عالم الغيب والشهادة هو الرحمن الرحيم هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر سبحان الله عما يشركون هو الله الخالق البارئ المصور له الأسماء الحسنى يسبح له ما في السماوات والأرض وهو العزيز الحكيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد And he mentioned his favors on us. الرحمن علم القرآن خلق الإنسان علمه البيان الشمس والقمر بحسبان
والنجم والشجر يسجدان والسماء رفعها ووضع الميزان ألا تطغوا في الميزان وأقيموا الوزن بالقسط ولا تخسروا الميزان والأرض وضعها للأنام فيها فاكهة والنخل ذات الأكمام والحب ذو العسف والريحان فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان.
The Quran is asking a question. How many of the ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will you deny? And we say, لا بشيء من نعمة ربنا نكذب. We say, oh Allah, we do not deny any of your ni'mat. So the first lesson is, make Allah number one in your life. And the last of that first lesson is, learn to make dua. Learn to make dua. And in learning to make dua, make it a habit to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first for everything. By all means, resort to your material means. There's nothing wrong with that. But if you have a headache, first make dua, then take a Tylenol. Don't reverse it. Monitor yourself. Anytime you have an issue of any kind, monitor yourself and think, what is the first thought that comes into my mind? Is it about a material means or is it about dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Which is the first thought that comes into my mind? Whatever the situation might be, what is the first thought that comes into my mind when I am looking at any blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Somebody sent me an advertisement for Mercedes, which shows this family in Australia. This family has been in this massive car crash, and then there's all of these fazail of Mercedes, of how the seat hugs you and how the airbags come out and how the thing crumples and this happens and that happens. And then there's this thing saying that these people are alive today because of Mercedes. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Somebody, one of my brothers sent me this clip, and I said to him, please send them a message and ask them, then what happened to Lady Diana? Very simple question. And the Mercedes in which Lady Di was traveling in was a far superior Mercedes than the one that these people were traveling in. Because this was an ordinary, garden variety Mercedes. That was a absolutely top of the line Mercedes, and it was armored. So how come she died? Think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. Life and death is not in the hands of Mercedes. It is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. It's not in the hand of any doctor. It's not in the hand of anybody. It's in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to live our lives completely in obedience to Him and to take us in a state when we are in obedience to Him jalla jalaluhu. Second lesson in my life which I learnt was to make Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sunnah my means of guidance. There are many ways of living your life, and many are good ways. There are many ways, and many are good ways. But there is only one way in which there is a guarantee of success. There is only one way in which you can never go wrong, and that is the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because it's only about the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ إِن كُنْتِمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَّحِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, say to them, ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who claim to love Allah, say to them, make my ittiba, follow me, emulate me, imitate me, do what I told you to do, and do what I did not even tell you to do only because you love me and you imitate me. Make me your brand. And what will happen? Then Allah will love you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive your sins, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most forgiving and most merciful. Because that is the only way which is guaranteed as the way to Jannah. The Sunnah of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the field book of the Quran. You know, in science we have this system of what is called a book of theory and what is called a field book. A field book is where the theory is applied. So there is a theory and you say, well, how am I going to apply this theory? What is the method? You go and look for that in the field book. The Sunnah of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the field book of the Quran. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala said, Aqimu Salah. Yes, Labbaik, Allahumma Rabbaik. Ya Allah, I am ready. How must I do that? Go ask Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Sallu kama araitumuni usalli. Aw kama qala alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, pray as you have seen me pray. I have mentioned all of these things in great detail in many khutab, so I am not going to repeat that here. Just a marker. The third thing is gratitude. Gratitude. And remember one very important thing in gratitude. You know, I realize this, alhamdulillah, bismillah ta'ala, I have had very good teachers in my life. And so a lot of lessons came to me very early in life. One thing I realized very, very early in life is that you can never repay anybody. You can never ever repay or pay back anybody. And you know why? Because they did it first. They did it when you needed it. They did it when they did not need to do it. They did it when you didn't even ask for it. How are you going to repay that? Because you are repaying because they did it. They did it without cause. You are repaying with cause. So there's no way that you can repay anyone who has done you any good. No way. It's not possible. You cannot pay back. What can you do? You can pay forward. You can pay forward. What's the meaning of pay forward? Carry forward what you learned. Carry forward that goodness. Do that to somebody else. I learned many things from my teachers. And I have spent the rest of my life teaching them to others. And I hope that in some way, I will be able to pay forward the favors that I received from them. Some were Muslim, many were not Muslim. It doesn't matter. It does not matter. A teacher is a teacher. Knowledge is knowledge no matter where it comes from. So always, always, always gratitude. Always thank. Never let a word of ingratitude come on your tongue. Very often we ask this question, especially in husband and wife, spouse relationships. You ask the husband, did you thank your wife for doing this? He said, oh, but she knows. Doesn't she know? So my simple question is, doesn't Allah know? Why then did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, la in shakartum la azidannakum wa la in kafartum inna azabi la shadid? Allah said, verily the one who thanks me, I will increase my blessing on him. And the one who is ungrateful, I will punish him. Let him be afraid and fear my punishment. Shadid. Azabi la shadid. My azab is very severe. Why is Allah saying that? Doesn't Allah know if you are thankful or not? Allah knows what's in your heart. Thankfulness and expressing thanks is not about the other person. It's not about whether they know or not. It is about you. It is about your attitude of gratitude. Of you expressing this. In the case of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is the expression of ubudiyat. It is the expression of the fact that you are a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are accepting and realizing that, and therefore you are thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the case of other people, it is a question of understanding and expressing this gratitude towards that person who went out of their way to help you, no matter how small it was. And that is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, very specifically he said, the one who has not thanked the people, lam yashkurin nas, lam yashkurillah. He has not thanked Allah. The one who has not thanked the people has not thanked Allah. So don't worry about whether, oh, but you see, they know or they don't know. It's not a question of whether they know or they don't know. It's a question of did you thank or not. If you have not thanked them, then you are among those who will be counted as ungrateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore Allah said, beware of his punishment. Be afraid of that. Third point is gratitude. Always thank. Alhamdulillah, I have tried to do that all my life. In my phone, Hazrat Umair, Rahmatullah Alayhi, has installed a program called TextPan Pro. So TextSpan Pro is a very nice but very buggy program. So he always does this. He installs buggy programs. So I have to keep on referring back to him to debug the program. What TextSpan Pro does, every once in a while it gives you a statistics about the terms that you are using the most often. So TextSpan Pro has this feature where you can have small English Roman script abbreviations for Arabic terms. It does it for all kinds of things, but Arabic terms. So for example, in my phone, if I type JZK, it puts there Jazakallahu Khairan. If I put ASA, it says Assalamu Alaikum wa Rahmatullahi wa Barakatuh. So those of you are wondering how I write all this Arabic so fast, this is the secret. I just write ASA and it comes there. Now, the point is that this statistics comes up. So one day he tells me, he says, which is the term that you use the most often according to TextSpan Pro? I said, which one is it? He said, Jazakallahu Khair. Said, Alhamdulillah. It is dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is making a dua for the person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you the best of reward. So gratitude, always, always, always thank people. Number four is discipline. As they say, we must all suffer from one of two pains. The pain of discipline or the pain of regret. We must all suffer from one of two pains. The pain of discipline and the pain of regret. And you know the key is to learn to love discipline. Not do things, not be disciplined as a, oh, this is a big pain in the neck which I have to somehow put up with. No. Learn to love discipline. Learn to love discipline because you understand and you see the value in it. Believe me, write these words of mine down. And then write them on, on something with zafran and put them in milk and drink them out. No matter what talent you have, a person who is disciplined and a person who is structured will always beat you. You will never ever beat a person who is disciplined and a person who has structure, no matter how much talent you have. Talent is highly overrated and structure and discipline is highly underrated. I know personally many people who have huge talent, amazing memories, amazing talent, do nothing. Look at the output, zilch, zero. People who make fantastic speeches, the whole audience is totally moved and everyone is sitting in a puddle of tears. But after the speech is over, it's gone. Now 1 week later you say, well, what did he say? Neither he remembers nor you remember. And you know why? Because they don't write it down. That is discipline. That is structure. Is to document. Is to record. So you can take it as a pain, oh my God, I have to document this thing. Or you can say, well, I wish to be remembered. I'm giving you only one example. Structure and discipline. A structured approach always beats an unstructured approach. So my fourth lesson is discipline and structure. Discipline begins with getting up in the morning and making your bed. Discipline begins in how you put your shoes in your, how you leave your shoes in your house. Are they arranged together or not? Discipline is to check your car and see whether it is polished and shining or not. And not because your driver did it, because you did it. Discipline is to see if your shoes are polished or not. It is the attention to detail. To quote Coco Chanel, who said, when you have fully dressed and completely accessorized and you are about to leave your house, turn around and look in the mirror and take one thing off. Not put one thing on, take one thing off. Why? Because the essence of style is to be understated, not in your face. That is the meaning of attention to detail. Very, very important. So, structure and discipline. Everything must be structured, everything must be disciplined. Sometimes these, my right hand and my left hand get very irritated with me. They seem to be getting more irritated nowadays because suddenly they have now discovered that they have got talent and they have got knowledge and all that. So, internally I laugh to myself and see, we'll see how long this goes on. So, they get very irritated with me. Why do I ask so many times? I said, the fact that I am asking so many times means that you are not doing what you are supposed to be doing. Close the loop. I say, do something. They would have done it. They won't tell me. So, I have to ask them. So, I've got an actual code for them. So, I tell them something. I WhatsApp the thing to them. Then, I send them an email. Then, I send them an SMS saying, look at your WhatsApp and look at your email. Then, I call them and say, did you see the WhatsApp and email? This is my process for... But I don't care because I'm very concerned about my parameters. So, I will do what I need to do, including bug the daylights out of them. So, I said, the day I'm gone, they'll say, Alhamdulillah, gone, khalas, because you know, all this bugging is gone. Structure and discipline. Make your life structured. It means sleeping less. It means getting up at the same time every day. It means being on a keto diet. What's the best thing I love about the keto diet is you stop worrying about food. You're not concerned about food anymore. You know, khatta salan hai kya nahi hai, bagara salan hai kya nahi hai, gosht ka salan hai kya nahi hai, gosht hai to murghi hai kya nahi hai. Hamare Hyderabad yahan pure pet pe se jaan tasadduq. You know, bilkul. With the keto diet, nothing. You eat two boiled eggs, you are good for the day. Khalas. End of the day, end of story. If you feel hungry, eat some nuts. Drink some water. Discipline. The thing I love about the keto diet is discipline. Put it into your life, say, you will not eat carbs, you will not eat sugars. Khalas, period. And then you also discover that there are people who are chefs in restaurants who do not know what is a cheese omelette. Can you believe it? Massive five-star hotel I go to, I say, can you give me eggs Benedict? He looks at me as if I'm talking about the Pope. For God's sake. I said, you don't know how to make Hollandaise sauce? He said, no. I said, very good. I don't have the time to teach you how to do that. I said, go look up on YouTube. Discipline and structure. Number five, learning. Learning is like breathing. You can't help it. How many people do you know who don't breathe? Right? Only dead people, right? So, just like that. Learning is like breathing. But just like breathing, learning will give you value only if you do that consciously and according to a system. You know, in yoga, there is this pranayam. And the people of yoga, they claim a lot of benefits about pranayam. You know, take the breath through one nostril and out through the other one and so on and so on. All the way. And they say it improves concentration and this and that and the other. Whatever. So, also, if you go to a gym and you are lifting weights especially, then there is a breathing pattern. You know, when you're lifting the weights, you exhale and you inhale and so on, and in terms of the reps and so forth, there is a breathing pattern. Now, why is all this being done? You're breathing anyway. So, why must I exhale when I'm doing something and I'm inhaling when I'm doing something? I'm exhaling and inhaling anyway. Well, what is the third thing to do? Because there is breathing and there is breathing. One is just drawing breath. The other one is doing it consciously, feeling it going inside, holding it for a while, feeling it coming out, and according to a system. Same thing applies to knowledge. Learning is free. Everybody learns. Everybody and his grandfather and his dog and his donkey and his cow, they all learn. Experience happens to you as long as you are alive. But experience in life is not what happens to you, it is what you do with what happens to you. Not one of my sayings, a very old adage. Everybody learns. Knowledge is free, knowledge is transferable, knowledge can't be stolen. Knowledge increases with sharing. Well, Ghazali rahmatullah was going in a caravan and they got waylaid by a gang of robbers. And in that whole turmoil, Imam al-Ghazali suddenly saw the robber chief with a naked sword standing in front of him. So he said to him, take whatever you want money, everything I'll give you, but don't take these. And he had his saddlebags. So the robber, the chief said, what is in this? He said, my books. So he said, what's in the books? He said, my knowledge. So he laughed at him. He said, what knowledge is this that somebody like me can steal it? He laughed at Imam al-Ghazali. He said, what knowledge is this that somebody like me can steal your knowledge? Imam al-Ghazali said, from that day I made it a promise to myself that I will memorize everything. I'm not saying that you should memorize. These people, they knew entire books. But the question I'm saying to you is very simple. Learning is automatic, but learning will happen only if you do it consciously and according to a system. And that system begins with adab. It begins with respecting knowledge and respecting the people of knowledge. Let me ask you a very simple question. If I give you the entire books of Imam Shafi Rahmatullah Ali, will you become Shafi? If I give you all the books of Imam Nawawi, will you become Nawawi? Imam Malik Rahmatullah Ali had thousands of students, but there was only one Shafi. There was only one Imam Shafi. Ramitur Rai and Imam Zuhri Rahmatullah Ali had thousands of students, but there was only one Malik bin Anas. Why? Ask yourself. The Faizan of Malik bin Anas was Am, whoever was coming. How come only one Imam al-Shafi rahmatullahi alayhi from that gathering? Is it because of Imam Malik or is it because of Imam Shafi? Which one? It is the student. The teacher will teach. The teacher is like a river. The river has water. Do what you want. Drink it, jump in it, drown in it, bathe in it, use it, positively, negatively. And that is one reason why, very paradoxically, some of the students who have the closest proximity of the teacher learn the least. They gain the least. They are the closest to the teacher. They may be living in the house of the teacher. The teacher may love them very much. We're not talking about that. But the knowledge of the teacher, they get nothing. And the reason they get nothing is because they treat the teacher like one of them. They treat the teacher as, ye toh hamare chai. You get nothing. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, Abdullah bin Abbas. Who is he? He is the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his brother. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam woke up in the night for tahajjud. Maybe 2:30, 2 o'clock, something like this. Who is narrating this? Abdullah ibn Abbas. Who is he? The cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How old was he at the time? Maybe 10, 12 years old. He says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam woke up in the night for tahajjud. I ran to get water for wudu for him. When he made wudu, I poured the water, he made wudu. Then he put his hand on my chest and he said, oh Allah, give this boy the understanding of your kalam. Ask yourself this question. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sleeping. He woke up at 2 o'clock. How does Abdullah ibn Abbas know that Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam woke up at 2 o'clock? Did he say Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam woke up and woke me up? No. He is saying, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wake up for tahajjud, which means what was he doing? Did he say, are he's my cousin? Are hamare bhai jani chhe na? Bole? Nahi bole. The ustad is the ustad. It doesn't matter. Maybe your own cousin, maybe your own brother. The ustad is your ustad. The day you discount the ustad, you have destroyed yourself. The day you have discounted the ustad, you have destroyed yourself. You know, among the Sufia, they say knowledge sine se sine mein ilm jo hai wo sine se sine mein jata hai. The people who are jahilun today, they think that you hug somebody and the knowledge transfer. That's nonsense. You are not two mobile phones, put one on the other and the data changes. Sine se sine means what? It means the dua of the ustad for the student. Every ustad will make dua for the well-being of the student. I'm talking about this dua. Oh Allah, put the knowledge of Quran in this heart. Same Abdullah ibn Abbas, many years later, he's a grown man. He was a wealthy man. His father, Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib, was a big time businessman. And Abdullah ibn Abbas at that time is the greatest mufassir of the Quran. He's one of the greatest ulama of Islam. He wants to ask somebody a question. There's some other sahabi, he wanted to ask him about some hadith, some question. So he comes out of his house and he realizes that this is now the siesta time, is the middle of the afternoon, it's very hot. So he goes to the house of that other person and in the shade of the wall, outside the house, he sits on the ground. And that person woke up and he came out of his house for Salatul Asr. Who does he see sitting outside? Abdullah ibn Abbas. He said, Wallah subhanAllah, why are you sitting here? He said, I came to ask you a question. He said, why didn't you knock on the door? He said, because I was afraid you might be sleeping, I would be disturbing. He said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilaihi rajiun. He said, you are the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You are the family of Muhammad. You are from the Ahlul Bayt. Your position to my position is nothing. He said, no. He said, no. I came to ask you. So I am your student. It doesn't matter who I am. I came to ask you my need. So I am your student. So I will wait. I will not inconvenience you. I will wait. When it is convenient for you, I will ask you, you tell me. Alhamdulillah, I have had many teachers. Till today I have teachers. Because the one who thinks he is free from Islah is sitting in the lap of Shaitan. The one who resents being corrected is sitting in the lap of Shaitan. Alhamdulillah, I am not among them. I have teachers, I have muslihin, I have people who correct me. And I go there and I sit at their feet and I ask for correction. And Allah is witness and they are witness. I have had many teachers. I am not saying I was their best student. But one thing, if you ask any of them, some of them are no longer here, but if they were here and if the ones who are here, not one single one of them will ever tell you that I discounted them or I disregarded them or I disrespected them or I was lazy or that I was someday I was late for a class or I did not do what I was told to do or I ever needed reminding. Allah is witness. Never. In my entire life, I'm 63 years old today. No teacher of mine ever needed to remind me about anything. No teacher of mine ever needed to ask me about something a second time. No teacher of me ever had to wait for me. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. My Rabb has guarded me never in my entire life. And that is the reason why, Alhamdulillah, I learned whatever I learned. As I said, I'm not saying I learned everything. I'm not saying I was their best student. But this much is definite. Not one of them will write a complaint to say he was lazy, he didn't come on time, he was, you know, I had to tell him something 20 times. No, ever, never, never. Not even a second time. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Number 6. Focus on contribution and not on consumption. Today, this is the biggest bimari, this is the biggest sickness that we have. We are focused always on consumption. Buying and buying and buying and possessions and possessions and possessions. Look at contribution. You want to see how powerful you are, see the number of people you have benefited. Focus on contribution, not on consumption. What is your share? What you contributed. Whether it is share of business, sometimes in my consulting practice, family businesses, we talk about division of business between the sons and so on. And sometimes the son comes to me and says, tell my father to give me my share. I said, sure, tell me, I'll tell your father, definitely. How much is your share? He says, 50%. I said, how did you come to that? When did the business start? When did you enter the business? How is it 50%? He said, nahi magar wo, you know, I said, no, what? What is your share of the business? He said, what do you mean? I said, what did you contribute in this business? That is your share. Not 50%. What did you contribute in this business? For a lot of them, the contribution is to dress up nicely and, you know, put some pack of rubber and perfume and then get into the nice Mercedes car and drive to work and come and sit there and drink some tea and go home. This is contribution. Focus on contribution. What is your output? And in my way of thinking, what I don't measure does not exist. What you measure exists. What you measure, you can control. What you measure, you know. So absolutely important. And that's the reason I say to myself, I will not allow what is not in my control to prevent me from doing what is in my control. It is not in my control to change the whole world, but it is in my control to try to change a few people. I keep doing that. Number 7. Relationships are more important than arguments. But they are not more important than principles. Remember this. Relationships are more important than arguments, but they are not more important than principles. Don't lose a relationship in order to win an argument. It doesn't matter. Lose the argument. Lose the argument. Maintain the relationship. But when the argument is about a matter of principle, especially obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, following the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then the relationship is not important anymore. Relationships are more important than arguments, but not more important than principles. Show respect to gain respect. You cannot gain respect without showing respect. And finally, value people, not things. The way of valuing people is to insist on quality. This is a big problem with our Muslim people. We think valuing people, we think good relationship means to take and accept substandard work. Sorry, I don't accept. Valuing somebody means to insist on quality. I will not take substandard work from you because I respect you. I expect you to give me top quality work because I respect you. If I didn't respect you, if I thought you were some piece of trash, then I would accept trash from you. But you are not some piece of trash. You are somebody who I love. You are somebody who I respect. So I expect top quality from you. And if you don't give me top quality, I'm sorry, I will be very upset. Which brings me to the point number 8, which is quality. One of the people who I see from time to time and read his sayings is the famous coach of the Green Bay Packers, Chicago Green Bay Packers. And one of the thing he talks about, he says winning. He said winning is not everything. Sometimes people say, you know, you lose and so on. He said, it's okay, winning is not everything. He said, true, winning is not everything. He said, winning is the only thing. Right? Winning is not everything. He said, winning is the only thing. Vince Lombardi, that's his name, Vince Lombardi. Winning is not everything. Winning is the only thing. And I say that about quality. Quality is not everything. Quality is the only thing. Quality is the only thing which counts. And quality comes from consistency. Not from doing something right once. In golf, we say a hole in one is a hole in one because it's a hole in one. Happens once in a blue moon. You have no idea how it happened. You just hit the ball and it went and landed inside the hole. And it's called a hole in one. If you can do a hole in one every single time, that's expertise. Expertise is repeatability. So quality comes from consistency. Consistency creates reliability. And reliability builds confidence and trust. Trust invokes respect and enables influence. It all begins with quality. You give a quality product and you give the same quality product every single time, people learn to trust you, they learn to rely on you for that product and service, which is when they stop worrying about the price. You can charge a premium for it. Gucci family slogan, quality is remembered long after the price is forgotten. You guys only buy the brands, you don't look at, you buy Chanel and you buy Gucci, but you don't look at the thinking behind it. Quality is remembered long after the price is forgotten. That's the Gucci family slogan. So quality, which comes from consistency, which is a factor of repeatability, which is expertise, which produces reliability, which builds trust and confidence, which invokes respect and enables influence. Look around you in the world. The most influential people in the world are the people who give you quality products and quality services every single time. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is respected. Why? Because he always, always, always gave quality. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was never late for anything. Today being late is the sixth pillar of Islam. Inna lillahi wa inna ilaihi raji'un. Every Muslim thing has to be late. If you are not late, then we have to question your iman. Are you really Muslim? Maybe you want to recite the kalima again. How come you are on time? Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was never late. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam never. And sometimes we think, we talk about breaking your promise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu, awfu bil uqud. He said, have wafa on your aqd. He said, have faith and keep your promise. So we think this promise only means some, great, big, intercontinental agreement. A promise is a very simple thing. If I said, I'll meet you at 2 o'clock, that's a promise. Now, either you meet me at 2 o'clock or if you are not able to come at 2 o'clock, before 2 o'clock, you call me and tell me why you can't come. If you just don't show up, I did that once in my life. And that happened like 2 weeks ago. My entire life, one time. And that's because I completely forgot. Totally blank. And it was not even in my calendar. That was an absolute big, 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 huge FOPA. I am saying this to publicly apologize to my very dear friend and brother Sharif Kotapurat. I gave him an appointment to meet him here in Hyderabad. He came from Bangalore, he and I think 3 or 4 people. And I was in Sri Lanka. And in Sri Lanka, these friends of mine, I was supposed to come here on the 13th. So I told Sharif bhai, come on 14th. Now on 13th, these friends of mine told me, we'll go to Vilpattu to the wildlife sanctuary. They said, do you have anything in pending, any appointments? So I looked at my calendar, it was blank. So I said, no, nothing, I'm free. So they said, we'll postpone your ticket and we'll go. I went off. So now I'm sitting in the middle of the boondocks. There's no phone, there's no signal, there's no nothing. When I come out of that place on the 16th or 17th, I see a message saying Sharif Kotapurat was here in Hyderabad. I said, oh my God, wallah. I mean, the first time in my life I did this and I had to do it to my dear friend Sharif. Completely heat. I totally forgot. I phoned him and I groveled and I said, please forgive me because I just did not remember. I mean, there's no way otherwise I would have missed, having given an appointment. Either I would have called him and said, please, I need to go to this thing and all the leopards there are asking for me. So, therefore change it. Or I would have just said, sorry, I can't come. Keeping your word. This is our izzah. Our word is our izzah. And our word, as I said, is not some great agreement. It is every single day. I will do this means what? Now, if you don't do that, it means that you have no respect for yourself. How do you expect anybody else to respect you? Remember, every single time you are breaking your word, you are knocking up one before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number one. And number two, your respect in the eyes of people is going down. People may not tell you that. But believe me, your respect in the eyes of people is going down. People don't respect you anymore because they know you can't be trusted. Anyone who has to be followed up is not somebody who is respected. Believe me. Because if you have to be followed up, it means that you are unreliable. If you are unreliable, you are not worthy of respect. You are a slave. You have to be followed up. You are like a cow or a bull or something. Unless I whack you in the behind, you won't do anything. Seriously, this is what you are saying about yourself. It's not me. You are making this statement about yourself. You are saying to the world, please don't rely on me. Please don't respect me. I am unreliable. I cannot be relied upon. Don't trust me. This is what you are saying to the world. Look in the mirror and ask yourself, is this how you want to project yourself? Seriously. Those who are like this, I hope you are seriously offended. So you will go and change yourself. Otherwise, believe me, your life is going to be very difficult. Very, very difficult. I don't know of anyone who is not respected, who is not reliable, who has succeeded. Not one single person. You will fail. Read my lips. Unless you learn to keep your word. Ninth, life is finite. Resources are finite. Time is finite. Therefore, be very clear about what you will do and be even more clear about what you will not do. We do not have time to waste. Forget social media. Forget attending these, you know, unending marriages. Somebody asked me, what do you do with your time? I said, I don't attend marriages I don't attend other people's marriages. I said, there's one marriage I needed to attend 35 years ago. I attended that. That was the khalas. Alhamdulillah. That was the only one in which I was needed. All the rest, his marriage I attended because I had no choice. But other than that, don't waste your time. Time is free. It comes. But the day we were born, the clock started ticking backwards. Neither you know nor I know how much time we have left. Don't waste it. Same thing with resources. Nobody has unlimited money. Nobody has unlimited energy. Nobody has unlimited enthusiasm. Use it where you get the biggest bang for the buck. Use it where you get the best leverage. Everything has a payoff. And everything has a price. There are no free lunches. There's no free breakfast, there's no free dinners, even on a keto diet. Everything has to be paid for. So be very clear, look at the price tag. If I am spending my time here, I am doing it at the expense of something else. Is it worth it? If it is not worth it, say no. Please understand, there's no question of being polite. Say no politely. Be nice about it, say no, big smile on the face. No, I'm not coming. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Bye-bye. But don't go. Do not go. Forget social media. Forget all this. Make sure that every single second of your life is accounted for and that you know what price you have paid for it and that you are happy with that price. Because the worst thing in the world is in the final days of your life, and I have lived long enough to see all that, final days of your life, you sit there and you look back in your life and you have regrets. Oh, I wish I had done this at that time. Oh, I wish I had gone there at this time. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajiun. There's no point that regret is worthless because you can't get it back now. No matter how much you cry, it's not going to come back. Use every single moment of your life because that is the only moment we have. Most of us spend our life either in the past or in the future. You're either dwelling on stuff which has happened, or you are afraid of something which has never happened, which may never happen to you in any case. Just think about this. Today, how much of conversation goes in useless political rubbish? How much conversation? I mean, almost all the time, you're only talking politics, politics, politics. None of us is in politics. All this talk in the world is not going to influence anything. It's not going to change anything. But what has happened is, your time has got spent in that. You're watching all kinds of nonsensical programs on television, which are based on politics. This talk show, that talk show. All of which is utter nonsense. Your time has gone in there. So please, ninth lesson, life is finite. Tenth and finally, the most important lesson, that one day we will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will not be asked what happened. We will be asked, what did you do? Allah will not ask you what happened, because Allah knows what happened. Allah will ask, what did you do? Today we are stuck with what happened. You know why I am against social media? The reason I am against social media is because social media gives you this deception of having done something. It deceives you into believing that you have done something by forwarding a message. And you think that, oh, I forwarded a message, therefore I changed somebody else's mind. Forget that. Just show me. How many petitions did you people sign till today? How many which float around? Did you follow up that petition to say, did any change happen? How many messages have you forwarded about Rohingyas? What has happened to the Rohingyas? How many messages have you forwarded about Palestine? What is happening in Palestine? I can give you any number of examples. The biggest problem with social media is it gives you an illusion of having achieved something. If you did not have that, you would actually get out of your comfort zones and you would go and create that change. You would go and actually take the pain to bring about the change. Social media gives you this. It's like something else which I don't want to mention here because we are sitting in the masjid. That's what social media is. Stop doing it. Be very clear in your mind. Do not waste your time. And remember that one day we have to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching. He's with us. So let us make sure that every action of ours is such that inshallah al-musta'an on the day of judgment, we will not be ashamed to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all of you, to accept your coming here. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this Ramadan the best Ramadan of your lives and to make every Ramadan that you get in your life the best of your life until the last one, which will be the best of the best when He will accept you in His presence. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jalla Jalaluhu to fill your heart with His Noor and to fill your life with His Barakah and to be pleased with you and never to be displeased. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept all your du'as and with afiyah and with khair. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, always ask Allahumma inni as'aluka al-afiyah fi dini wa dunya wa al-akhirah. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for afiyah. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept all your du'as with afiyah, all your du'as with khair, all your du'as with all the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you all that you ask with afiyah and then to add to that from His generosity and grace. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you from all evils, those which are visible and those which are hidden. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you from all kinds of wasabis of shaitan and of your nafs. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept you in the path of the work of His deen and to accept this work from you, to take this work from you, to make you tired in this work and to give you the energy to continue this work day after day after day until the day you meet Him, Jalla Jalalu. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil kareem wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.